My entire life, from the time I was age 2 and a half, I wanted to know who I am, what I am, and why I am. And I would ask my parents unendingly. I never stopped questioning. Thank goodness I was not bound into a religion or a denomination in Christianity. I had been baptized. And I used to wish I had a church to go to and understand these things. But in my adulthood, I am most thankful that I was given this freedom by my mother and father to seek anything I so desired. I didn't even comprehend at the time of this openness and expansiveness was part of my discovering who, what, and why I am. When I was 30 years old, I was in an automobile wreck with my wife, my daughter, in the car. Had two children at this time. As the car is ready to almost hit us, and this is all so quickly, I flash completely out of body. I did not know where I was and what that was. I just knew I don't exist in body anymore. I actually comprehended the length of time of this, about 30 seconds. Wreck is over and everybody seems alive, but I am literally coming down through a color wave spectrum. I had no words for that either. It's just the experience is happening to me, and I'm very conscious of this vividness of all color. Later to discover my eyesight, which was, I did wear glasses like 20/40. Well, I went back to 20/15 vision after this experience. When I looked at the trees and the clouds, and it was a beautiful day, the color contrast overwhelmed me. And I'm sitting in the back of a police car. I had no way to explain this to anybody, but I knew only one thing, and that is you cannot die. And this journey then, starting with that, I found myself in a health food store, and I was sudden looking at things and how reading about people's thoughts on water and the kind of foods I should eat, and reading four translations of the Bibles, all footnotes. My wife actually said at one point, I would thought you're going crazy if I didn't see that every single thing that is happening is good. Well, this went on for about 2.5 years of just intensive deep study, staying up all night studying, energized constantly, go right to work from it. And then someone hands me a little book called The Man Who Tapped the Secrets of the Universe. I rejected it 3 times. I rejected it only because I was doing deep studying of something else. It was literally a man named Edgar Cayce, and I was looking at earth changes and studying that. So my day I said I would accept it was on my birthday, September 15th, 1978. And the page I opened to in this marvelous book of this astounding man, Master of the Five Arts and Science, and there's pictures of some of his sculptings in there, of Thomas Edison, Mark Twain, President Roosevelt. And there's one of a man named Charles Goodyear, the founder of vulcanized rubber. Well, my hair stood up right on end because that statue set in my hometown, and I grew up as a child, a young teenager to a young man, age 12 to 18, working at that county courthouse with this great sculpting in our next to the courthouse in a park. I was admired the statue always. I thought it was important that a community like mine was, Akron, Ohio. Here's a sculpting. It must be an important community. And I look at this book, and there's the picture. And it certainly, I believe, in a symbolic universe, too, and it just symbolically said, well, you are to read this book. Well, the book became immediately life-changing. We didn't have internet. We didn't have Amazon. I tried to find this book because it was a borrowed book, and I could not find a book. So I finally wrote to the place. It said University of Science and Philosophy, Waynesboro, Virginia. I write. Within 5 days, I have a letter returned from Lao Russell. When I met her, I knew that God had fulfilled exactly what I asked, and that I was in. I picked up immediately, and I went into this marble palace and I'm looking at all these colossal great statues around me. Inspiration of the artwork done by Walter and Lao Russell. But I went right to the books. And I went to a book called The Secret of Light, and I felt if I opened that book and it says what I felt just somewhere inside, it would say the words like, and I just went, oh my God, this is it. This is what I've asked for my whole life. This is going to tell me. And I knew that I was going to read every word they ever wrote. And I unfolded that experience. Akron, Ohio is 500 miles away from here. I drove 1,000 miles every 2 months for 10 years to be with Lao Russell.
I first came to Swannanoa in 1985 and met Lao Russell. And what spoke to me so much was that she was so fully alive. And she talked about all the subjects, I do remember this, she talked about all the subjects that so many people stray away from, and that is love, and living fully in your life, and how to give love to another, and that we all are love. And that to me was the essence of who she is. And studying the history of her, she lived her life that way because she was a very aware and conscious being early in her life, and that permeated over all the years that she was alive.
My grandfather was one of 11 businessmen who purchased Swannanoa Palace and about 450 acres of land for the commercial potential of a hotel and a restaurant. And they deemed the Swannanoa Palace a white elephant, meaning they had no real purpose for it. They opened it in 1947, after World War II, as a historical building that people could come and take tours of. And then they received a visit from Walter and Lao Russell, who at the time were living in Carnegie Hall in New York City. And they all went to Farmington Country Club, where my grandfather was a founder. And over dinner, they had a fist bump that agreed that the Russells would come to Swannanoa and relocate here from Carnegie Hall. I actually have in my safety deposit box a dollar bill that they all signed as a testimony of their good faith to do that. There was no contract, it was more of a handshake. And the Russells were then given dominion and control, essentially, of the Swannanoa Palace and curtilage. And over the years, they operated it with two businesses, really. One was what Lao Russell called a shrine of beauty, which meant essentially that her very prolific husband, who was an artist and a sculptor and a poet and a musician and an architect, and it gave a place for him to gather a lot of his work for people to see what you can do when you're working knowingly with the power of God. And so that shrine was dedicated in 1949 and basically was kept at this location for slightly over 50 years. At the same time, they operated a worldwide home study university in universal law, natural science, and living philosophy, and marketed their books as well worldwide from this location.
I came to the university by reading the Unit 1 that I found on a friend's kitchen table. I read it several times and got hooked, and that's what led me to join the group in Newcastle, Delaware, that led me to the palace, to meeting Russell and working here for a couple of years.
Well, I came to the palace through Jim. He introduced me to Lao, and my first encounter with her was her coming out of the basement steps, and she looked at me, she goes, "Haven't we met somewhere before, dear?" And of course, that stayed with me forever, trying to figure out where that might be. And then having read the material and just got hooked, and here we are.
My first experience with Walter and Lao Russell came on the very day they dedicated their University of Science and Philosophy here at Swannanoa, when they had moved in and brought people from all over the United States to the gates of this restored palace. in 1949. I was 9 years old. My father and mother brought me up here. My grandfather had sold the land to Major Dooley to build this palace on, and my father's interest through the years was ever more whetted when he read that Walter and Leo Russell were coming to open it back up after years of neglect. Within a week or two, I had been given a copy of The Man Who Tapped. I was 10 years old. I don't know how it really influenced me, but it impressed me. It certainly taught me how to cut the grass in patterns, geometric patterns. And when I was 16 and a senior in military school in Waynesboro, I was given a copy of Leo's own first book, God Will Work With You But Not For You, by my mother. By this time, Leo was a close friend and a client of my father's. He was an attorney in Waynesboro, and that relationship continued for two generations. I was her lawyer after he passed away, and they were very dear friends. She used to call and talk to me through the years every two or three weeks. I wish the conversations at times had been more cosmic, but they were always kind, and they were always from the heart. She was a wonderful person, a wonderful friend. I count it a great privilege to have been a confidant, and I suppose I'd have to say the great influence on my life was reading that God Will Work With You But Not For You. It's a marvelous message, beautifully told, and I guess the New York Herald Tribune touted it as one of the 10 best books of, I think, 1955 or 56. I thought so too, for what it counted.
Well, actually, I came to this teaching. I was in high school, living in Canada. My physics teacher actually gave me a book about Walter Russell, The Man Who Tapped the Secrets of the Universe. And what I responded to more was the teacher's enthusiasm for the book and for Walter Russell's work. That's what I responded to. I approached him after class, asked him if I might borrow it, read the book, and it was like brand new material, fresh material. I was raised Catholic. I was frustrated with the religion. Never really understood the religion, never felt it gave an explanation. And when I read that book, I said I knew I found home. And I eventually read all of the books. I was only a teenager. I was 17 years old. Every birthday, every Christmas, I asked my dad, look, I need more of this material. And he supplied me with the home study course. I hung on the mailbox each month waiting for that course material. And it was about 2 years later, I felt I just had to meet Leo. And that's what drew me to Swannanoa. And I would say if there was any one book that really made me feel the urgency for their message and their work, it was their book, Atomic Suicide. Because it made me realize that man's greatest error was in introducing atomic fission, thinking that they're bringing life, bringing energy, and yet introducing the death principle of nature as a source of energy. And that's what made me realize that this work was urgent. I had to go and help Leo in any form possible. And that's what really brought me to her work.
I discovered the works of Dr. Walter and Leo Russell probably when I was about 14 years old at a bookstore in New York. I came across The Man Who Tapped the Secrets of the Universe, and I was captivated at that moment. And then I was able to, I found The Message of the Divine Iliad and really The Secret of Light. And I read The Secret of Light at quite a young age, and it was a very powerful experience for me. And it was something that kind of motivated me at that time, among other spiritual teachings, to go very deep into this understanding of the mystical consciousness. So as I got a little bit older, I began actually to speak to people about these teachings. And we recommended The Secret of Light to hundreds of people and probably sold hundreds of books back in the 1980s and late 1970s and early 1980s. So I was fortunate to be able to come to Swannanoa in 1986 and meet with Leo, and it was just an extraordinary experience to be with her and to, you know, see the palazzo here and all the beautiful people. And that's pretty much how I came to the teachings, and you know, here I am over 40 years, almost 40 years later, and still going strong.
We were attending a conference in Virginia Beach, and someone we were talking with at the time said, oh, there's this wonderful place just right off the interstate. You ought to stop there and visit. They play music to the plants. That's all we knew. So it was right on our way home. We went off the interstate. She told us where to get off. We came up the mountain. It was in the fog. It was late in the evening. It was already a little bit after closing time. But they let us come in the door, and we met Lao Russell during that time, although we didn't meet her immediately at that point in time.
One of the things that first attracted me to Walter and Leo's work was when I walked in the door and I saw these paintings up on the wall. And I had a similar vision, and I thought, oh my gosh, this guy's been there. He's not only been there, he's painted it. And we walked around and we looked at everything in the place. It was just so magical, so powerful.
Before we left, we did take the homesteady course home with us. And it basically changed our outlook on life and the relationship that we had with each other at that point in time.
It wasn't just a home study course. We got into all their books. And we would sit and read for hours and meditate on what we were reading. It's important to not just read the material, but allow enough space after 40 minutes or so to your mind to absorb the material. And then pick it up again. And then to be able to live material, that's the next step.
I was up in this area in 1962, 52 years ago, and in sales. I've been in stainless steel cookware sales for over 50 years. And I'm always curious about, you know, places, and I didn't even know Swannanoa existed here. But I came up the driveway, and right before me, I saw what I saw in a dream previously. Very vivid, especially in the garden. I saw in the garden the exact detail of those gardens. Prior to that, I did not know that there was a place called Swannanoa. And so that was the opening. And that was also what made me become very curious. And then after that, I was passionate about meeting Mrs. Russell. Also, I got The Man Who Tapped the Secrets of the Universe, of which I've given out a couple thousand copies of that book over the years, because it's a book that all mankind should read if they can comprehend the little books. A simple book. But we call it a little magic book because it has all those basic principles in a nutshell. And after reading that little book until 2 o'clock in the morning, not long after coming up here, I had an incredible spiritual encounter. The Holy Spirit came right in my room in the form of a white dove, came right in a sealed window. And then I had this illumination that was beyond any words I could describe to you. Basically, which was, I thought that I was leaving this world and I was very happy, but it came back. So that was the beginning for me. But what that did, it put in me a drive to be a helper. And we started being volunteers here for the next 25 years that Mrs. Russell was here. And as often as we can, whenever they allow us, even currently.
In 1982, I left Pennsylvania with my husband and my son, who was a few months old, and we were looking for a new home. We were camping. It was beautiful. It was the springtime, and we found the woods in Virginia it was because it was Easter, we decided to go out and explore, and we came up on Efton Mountain and we saw the sign for Swannanoa. When we came up, there were cars in the driveway, and it was very exciting because people must have known things we didn't know. So we were like, what's going on? And we went in with them, and they were going, she's coming down, she's coming down. And so we stood there with everyone, not knowing anything about it, and all of a sudden, by this Tiffany window on these marble staircases, this woman was there, and I just said to myself, that's a lady. I've never seen a lady in my life, but that is one. And she just came down. She was, she was ageless. I'm sure it was close to, you know, when she passed, but she just glowed. There was just an awe over the entire room. She came right up to me. She put her hand on my baby's head and she said, oh, he will be someone someday. And I just never felt so proud in my life. And I had no idea what this place was or anything about it. And that came later. When I finally moved to Virginia with my family, I ended up meeting Patty Snyder, and she said that there was a summer position at Swannanoa on the grounds. And I came up and I got hired, and that was in 1992. Well, by the end of the summer, I was maintenance manager, and I had a permanent job, and that was 22 years ago. And I want whatever happens in the future to be what the Russells would have wanted.
I looked up at a stained glass window of Lewis Comfort Tiffany's, one of his greatest pieces ever, of a Grecian goddess with her arms unfolded. Spectacular piece, and I'm concentrating on it thinking, I don't care what reason any of these other people are here for, they're not here the reason I am. If that woman would just give me a moment alone with her. And she said, Michael, would you like to come upstairs and have tea with me? And I said, I certainly would. And she said, and that's what we did. We started up these steps, all these other people have been talking, kind of looking us going away. And I had sort of had this feeling as we were walking up each of these steps, oh my God, this is it, because this is what I've asked for and it's happening, and I think I'm scared to death. And we went into her conference room, and it was magical. It was magical how she treated me, questions and answers and sharing time together. And I knew this is the change of my life. Didn't know what it mean, but it was the change of my life. In this first encounter with Lao Russell, we were nearing what was seeming a natural length of time of being together in her conference room. And I felt imperative to say something to her of, I'm going to help you. I want to help you. And I didn't know how that meant. I said, well, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to take this little book, The Man Who Tapped the Secrets of the Universe by Glenn Clark about Walter Russell, and I'm going to give this to people. And I said it with the conviction that I'm the first person that had this astounding thought of something to do. Well, the book had been selling for 33 years at that particular point that I say it, and I certainly wasn't the first with the thought. But Lao Russell was so sweet, she said back, she said, you know, Michael, that would just be the most wonderful thing to do, because that little book is just a walking piece of energy. She said, you know what? If they don't get it after they read that book, well, I just don't think they're going to get it this time around. And I was in agreement, and I got a case of books, and I said, I know the mayor of this town, my town. I know the chief of police in my town. And I know the candlestick maker and the coal miner and the man who builds tires. And I'm going to start sharing this book with people. It's such deeply inspiring. I didn't know how deeply that would possibly change my life, because over, as I'm giving this little talk at 2014, I'm saying these words in 1978. So for 36 years, I've been giving that book out over 1,500 times on a one-to-one basis. And I believed and understood for myself that the most power we could ever have is whenever two or three of us are gathered. And that's how I viewed this. And I just didn't go just handing the book. In fact, on my way home, I had another flash of light. And that flash of light, I saw exactly that I should write an inscription on it. And that inscription said to write to the person's name, and then it said, may this little book add new dimensions of insight and inspiration to your life. And I said, most sincerely, it was my signature, and I would date it. And I've never changed that ever in 36 years. And I knew that was seared out of my heart, so I wasn't going to change it. And that was really my beginning of coming home and just sharing this book with people. And then one day at our church, First Congregationalist Church in Akron, Ohio, the oldest church of Akron, Ohio, and a church esteemed with great ministers over its history, a new minister was coming. And this new minister was named Dr. Gabe Campbell, and he came from the East Coast in Stamford, Connecticut. And I heard he was going to come, and we listened to his sermon, and I had a little book, and I signed it to him. And I was standing in line with my wife, and I'm going to hand this book to this man. I go to hand the book to him when I meet him, and he goes, Leo, you know Leo? Well, I just couldn't believe it. I said, you know Leo? He said, oh, absolutely. I said, this is unbelievable. This church has no idea what's coming here. And he leans down to my ear and he says, that's all right. He said, we'll be teaching him reincarnation without him having any idea that's what's happening. And I leaned back and just said, what a ride we're in for. Within the week, he calls me in and said, I'd like to do a sermon. And I'd like to do the sermon on illumination. And I said, that in itself could be astounding. I don't think 99% of the people in Christian churches comprehend truly illumination or Jesus' experience. And he said, yes, that's exactly why. And I want to connect Jesus and then speak a sermon on Walter Russell. I thought, wow. And he said, not only that, I want to be able to tell the people that after this sermon, in the evening, that you, anyone having further interest, you'll discuss it with them because in your trunk you have the books. I went, you want me to discuss something? I'd never in my life never spoken to anyone about God. I felt, well, I guess this is the first chance this is going to happen. And that is exactly what happened. He gave the sermon. After the sermon, a woman comes up to me that I knew in high school. Very casually in high school, just hello, goodbye. And she said, Michael, I'm so excited to finally learn about Walter and Leo Russell. And I said, well, how did you know them? And she said, well, I have statues of Walter and Leo Russell. And I said back, you can't. I don't know what you think you have, but you couldn't be having statues of them. She said, well, it says they're WR written in the side of them and dated 1955. And I've got a little piece of paper that says Walter and Leo Russell. I said, this is impossible. I said, but I'd like to see them. She said, oh, no, I don't want you to. I'm bringing them. I want to give them to you. And I said, I don't think you can't give me what you don't have. So I immediately called Leo Russell. And I said, Leo Russell, I'm going to be given these statues. I said, impossible. And she said, oh, Michael, you ye of little faith. She said, of course they're us. 1950, we made 50 sculptings, sketch model replications 9 inches tall of Mark Twain, Thomas Edison, President Roosevelt, and of ourselves, Walter and myself, that we had sculpted. We made 50 and we never made them again, and they sold to students. And I said, well, apparently I got a woman that said she has a sculpting and gonna give them to me. And she said, well, Michael, isn't that so wonderful? You were meant to have them. And I certainly, I have them to this day and treasure them. What I had asked for also, deep spiritual connection to Leo Russell, intimate spiritual connection. And I felt from the very beginning, the closer this woman allows me to her, I will also become that close to Walter Russell. And that proved to bear itself out also. for anyone that had given study to their book Atomic Suicide, and I had, and I had done deep study of it, and it was so profoundly awakening of our ignorance of radioactivity to a fact that we had exploded hundreds upon hundreds of nuclear bombs, both out at sea and both in Nevada. By 1981, a woman named Helen Caldicott had written a book, Nuclear Madness, and there was more, and 3 Mile Island, we were in about the second year after its unfolding. Slowly there was more, and it was a heavy fear factor also, but slowly we were starting to have some kind of consciousness that poor Walter and Leo Russell, when they wrote the book in 1957, and the energy they put into the book. I'm sharing this with my wife. I will share this also with you. My wife had never been here yet. She accepted what she was seeing with me, and it was good, but I come home with a book called Atomic Suicide, and the cover of it even had like dripping blood. Well, I would set this book down. Every time I would come by my books, I've never in my life set a book down with its face down, ever. Never even knew I had this habit, but always face up. So I'd set this book down. Every time I'd come home from work, that book would be turned with the face down. And I couldn't understand. I'd turn it again, I next it down. I finally said to my wife, I said, you know, do you have any idea why that is happening? And she said, yeah, I'll tell you. She said, I'm doing it. I said, why? She said, because people come in the house and they say, what in the heck is that? And it's embarrassing to me. It scares them, and I don't know what the heck you're doing studying it. I said, I'm studying about our insanity of these nuclear power plants we're bringing across this world, and this is telling the truth about it. And she said, well, it's scary. I said, oh, good. I'm glad it scares them. I want them to read the book. Well, fairly soon after that, one day, my wife comes in the door and she says, I've been listening to National Public Radio on the way home. I said, yeah. She said, there's a woman named Dr. Helen Caldicott, a Harvard physician, that has been speaking out about radioactivity from a book called Nuclear Madness. I said, yeah, wow. And she said, well, she said on National Public Radio, I would like to see all mothers come to Washington, D.C. on Mother's Day in protest with their children of this insanity. I said, yeah. She said, I'm going, and I'm taking the children. She had never in her life gone anywhere alone or without another, never. And I said, you're what? She said, I'm taking our two oldest. Oh, you had an infant. I'll take care of the weekend, you go. I said, I'll get Leo Russell to sign Atomic Suicide. And you give it to her if you can possibly see her. Well, astoundingly, the event unfolded. They went, there was over 500,000 people come to this experience on Mother's Day. She has our children there, and she meets Helen Caldicott. And I've got a picture of her presenting the book as Helen is looking in at the inscription of Atomic Suicide. My wife came back from Washington, D.C. with the children. She said, we got to do something about this. So she said, well, maybe we could do something with our group that we had in singing. We could sing at people. Or maybe we could create just a lecture and interaction, social action. She said, well, let's bring the people back into our home again. And I said, maybe that's why I've been saving all these articles. I'll Xerox them. We brought the people back in our home starting in August 1981 and said, some of us have children. What do you think about radioactivity? Well, I really don't know anything about it, most people said. Would you like to know something? Well, it scares me. I said, good. Would you like to know something about it? Started handing out these sheets of paper. Let's meet together again in a month. We would. People had read some things. Well, this is appallingly, this is scary. Well, let's do something about that. One writer of songs, his name was Tom DeFrange. I gave him a few books of Walter and Leo Russell. During the summer, we went away on a vacation up on Lake Erie. He came with us, and he went away to this little island spot quite a few times, and he was reading their books. And he would come back saying, this is astounding. what I'm reading. That's about all you would say on it. One time, on December 6th, of a cold winter night, he calls our house and said, I just had the most astounding experience happen. He said, I wrote a play. He said, I wrote it in 6 hours. I said, he said, I've never written a play in my life. I write songs. I said, well, what is it? He's called. He said, it's called Alice in Blunderland, Reflections in a Nuclear Age. I said, wow, that sounds good. I said, you know, read me something. Well, he read me a few lines of, I'm going, my God, Tom, I think we got a God spell here. He said, you do? I said, can you get over here right now? And it was snowing terrible. December 6, 1981, he said, well, yeah. And he comes over and he's got a spiral notebook. And we start reading this and went, this is a God spell. This is phenomenal. I'll give you an example. The cat says one time, is being asked by Alice, well, what does this mean in the newspapers when the rabbit's missing or something? She said, well, he's on the far left of the far right between the liberals and conservatives gaining minority support from the moral majority. Ta-da! I just listened. I thought, these words are astounding. I said, maybe you even your brother, who was also a songwriter, you could write songs to this. And he said, well, yeah, maybe we could, which unfolded to be 8 songs coming very quickly. So the next thing we do is say, let's get this group that we've had together. Let's meet at the Newman Center of Kent State University. So our oldest daughter had already been an actress in plays since she was 4 years of age, and we knew professional costume designers. Went to them, talked about this, and they were just so overwhelmed what we're trying. They said, we'll make you professional costumes, the best ever, free. And then we said, well, we really want to act well. So we went to the Cleveland Playhouse and found great acting instructors, and they found out what we wanted to do and said, we will come and we will teach all of you and we will do this free. We said, we've got all this, let's get started. And we went to a church and talked to a Lutheran church that had many of the chairmen of the boards of Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company and other rubber companies were members. I say that because there was great conservatism in this church, and we're going to perform this play. Well, most of us are scared to death. Well, we gave this performance. The audience was fully standing up, and almost all men in this audience were sobbing. And we just looked at each other and went, oh my God. I knew it then. We've got it. We have something to speak and say. And the vehicle works because we are addressing the right brain. We are addressing truth through the play, just like, you know, and we were doing it in churches. And theater started in churches. And we could set the play up anywhere, very simply with these little trees and call it Blunderland and little magical mirror with Mylar hanging and Alice comes from the audience. And my oldest daughter played Alice. Our whole family was in it. We had 25 people, 5 families. And we started. And we were asked to do that play one time. Well, as soon as we were done with the play, different individuals came up to us from different churches and said, would you perform that play at our church? And I guess we said, well, I guess we could perform it again. We had like 5 plays we had done, or done the play 5 times. We say we wanted to be in Washington, D.C., and we wanted to perform this in the United States Capitol. In 1 year, from that statement, we were performing the play in the United States Capitol in the Cannon Caucus Room. We had 4 senators, 8 United States congressmen. We had a full audience. We created the stage coming in. We made this thing happen. We had every major press of the country there, from Storer Broadcasting to Christian Science Monitor to ABC, NBC. CBS came, filmed us for television news that night. We performed the play hundreds of times to over 250,000 people. Everything we were really doing was exactly as Walter Russell and Lao Russell had asked. We were giving loving service, presenting the truth, and bringing different mindsets and ideas together for one purpose of love. And the truth was being said for this play, and we let the play do the work. And it worked. And we did the play up to 1991, until we finally said, my daughter who started this play when she was 11 and a half years old is in college. We've made her costume 4 different times. She can't keep driving home for this. We've got to end. We did our last play to 6,000 people, said we're done, and 1 week after we finished our last play, the Soviet Union collapsed. Yep, the Soviet Union collapsed 1 week when we finished. So that was probably the most powerful experience ever. And Lao Russell, every time, she was so thrilled about this because she said, somebody is finally doing something. And she would write letters. Every time I would read a letter in green room when we would all have our hands in circles, I'd read a letter. So the inspiration was profound and palpable. I'll tell you how much she loved it. The year that they wrote Atomic Suicide, they sold 15 copies. And I walked a mountaintop with her one time, and she was just so discouraged of what that, I felt it so deeply from her. All this incredible effort, 15 copies to sell, of trying to scream from the wilderness to awaken humanity.
I was blessed to have discovered the Russells through Michael Hudak. I was a member of the cast of Alice in Wonderland, his play produced by Legacy in the early 80s. And he knew of my wish and my desire to help children learn to treat each other better all over our planet. And he said, do you need to meet Lao Russell? Because she had a program called the Character Clubs, and maybe you could help her. So it was Michael Hudak who brought me here to the University of Science and Philosophy. My thoughts of Michael Hudak is not an experience, but a sense of him as being a man who is self-effacing of his ego. He was always, he was a predominant force in the creation of Legacy, in the way the whole 3 or 4 years that we worked and did our play functioned. But he was personally self-effacing. He was in the background being effective. The real energy and the real force and the heart behind it all was Michael. And I knew that. And he had a self-effacing quality. And that's why I wasn't surprised when he became the person who put out his hands and allowed the work and let the work and the future of what we would all know of Walter and Lao Russell come into his hands. Because again, he was the self-effacing Michael Hudak and let the spirit and the beauty be Walter and Lao Russell and their work.
I first met Michael Hudak in 1985. Lao Russell made the decision to put some younger people on her board of directors at that time. And Michael and I both came in at the same time. And so we kind of connected just because we were newbies at the same time. And we were having dinner at the top of the marble staircase with Leo and some of the other board members at that very first meeting where I met Michael. And Michael and I were sitting together, and we turned to Leo and we said, well, why do you have us younger people on this board? And she looked at us and she said, it's for overlapping of life cycles. For the same reason that I was much younger than Walter, to keep the transmission going, then we have to overlap it with younger people. I've had a lot of good times with Michael. Michael is, he's a real gem. He's somebody that I've really supported as president of the University of Science and Philosophy because he's authentic. He's somebody that was tapped by Lao Russell herself, who's faithful to the letter and the spirit of the message. And he's a very worthy messenger, and I'm really honored to be his friend and his co-worker and collaborator in this process. With the Center of the One Heart, we try to be a group of messengers, and I think we strengthen the message, because without the messengers, where would the message be? And so you have to have both. And so I really honor Michael for being the custodian over the last decade or so of the written word, of the message. And we've enjoyed extending the messengership circle as well.
I think the biggest moment I cherished with Michael was on the phone. When I was on the phone with him, maybe last year, and he described to me his experience about going to see the grandchildren or great-grandchildren of Walter Russell, and what it was like to walk in that home and see all of Walter's works everywhere, and just, you know, it gave him a deeper feeling and essence of who Walter was, and, you know, the family that he came from. And I could tell that it was just a really special moment for him. And so I to be in that awareness and that consciousness, you know, with my love and my respect of Walter's work, you know, that's one of the most memorable things that I can share about Michael and my time with him.
What I do know about Michael that impresses me is that he has an absolute devotion and love for this work and for the message. And he has the ability to give bits and pieces of information to people about it that you might not otherwise think about. It's a gift, and he's been a wonderful gift to the university.
And he's always there to answer your questions and take the time out of whatever he may be doing in his home life, and just is there lovingly and supportive.
I agree.
Michael and I had joined the board approximately the same time. I had been Leo's friend and lawyer for many years, but in the mid-80s, I believe it was, she decided to bring younger people, if you could imagine, I was young then, on the board and form the connection with the next generation. Michael had been here, had met her, and had studied their works, and she was a choice. Richard Delaney, I believe, came on the board the same time, maybe a year or so earlier. But anyway, I remember meeting Michael and getting to know him very well then. And at the time Leo refolded, I was here just after she had been taken to the hospital. I spent the night here working with two ladies who were here with her on an appropriate obituary. It was a shock to us all, a very sudden thing. We weren't certain that she had not just entered into the light for a short period, but it was pretty obvious soon that she had refolded. And Bill Cranwell, my colleague on the board, came, and the two of us were the only directors here that first 24 hours. There were some important safeguards that had to be undertaken. Of course, we had Margaret was on the staff then, Margaret Rue, and there were people that were very trustworthy and appropriate and deeply involved in the work. But the question was, as we were planning the funeral, which was the following Sunday, who would deliver an appropriate eulogy? And Bill Cranwell, ever modest in his way and so powerful in his in the force of his personality, declined. And I certainly thought Leo Russell deserved more than some local attorney, so I stepped aside. And we decided, the two of us, that the proper person to deliver that eulogy was coming in from Akron, Michael Hudak. And that day he more than filled the role. He filled it with his entire heart. He enraptured those who loved and were there to mourn Leo, and really to rejoice in the message that she had espoused and lived. We all realized the fact that you cannot die as she had written, but we took great comfort from the words he gave that day in the baronial hall at her funeral. There was a large, large crowd. Representatives of the British Embassy were here, a lot of prominent people. And then we walked to the grave behind the coffin, said a few other words. But Michael really shone on that day, and it didn't surprise anybody when we soon elected him president of the university. He, a position which he's held intermittently and for the most recent longer tenure, with great wisdom and great dedication.
I would say the most special memory I have of Michael Hudak is that every year he would come, and it was practically always the same time each year he would come, and he treated it as a pilgrimage to the work and a pilgrimage to see Leo. And it was a bright spot in Leo's year that Michael would come to visit. And I remember in particular one day they had spent many hours in conversation, and I just remember the lightness in Leo. And it was always special that when Michael came each year, and he really had a great grasp for the teachings and a great grasp for the work. And I'm always eternally grateful for that. Yeah.
So I remember Michael when I came here in 1986, in the winter of 1986. And I was always, there were a number of people here at the time that were kind of shepherding the work with Leo. And over the years, the ensuing years, I've kept in touch with JB as well. And it was always important to me to see how the progress of the work was going on. So I would oftentimes visit the website, and I always shared the books and the knowledge with many people. And I have come back now in 2014 at this beautiful homecoming gathering, and reconnecting with Michael has been really one of the highlights of my trip down here. And to see the work continue and the message continue to get out, and I think now more than ever the message needs to be heard by many more people, because Dr. Russell is really a forgotten figure in America, but you know what he gave and the level of excellence and beauty that he shared, both artistically and scientifically, is unprecedented, I think, in this country. And to have people like Michael and others who are helping spread the word and support the work, I think it's vitally important for the future of this country.
Michael, to me, is a man who really has tried hard, and he does walk his talk. One of the most wonderful moments I've had with Michael was one of his hardest in his life. And it was a really heart, I had not really made a heart connection with him to that moment. It was a deeply personal moment for him and for me. But I really saw a spiritual being. I really saw a spiritual being in Michael that I appreciate. I feel like he is the greatest example of a president we can have right now in the university. I feel like he holds it together in a really heartfelt way. He's really nice and personal to be around, but it's all these other things he's done with his life, with his family, and putting this energy out that to inspire people with Leo Walter Russell's work and his own work, and exemplify that.
He's really held the university together. When they were trying to find their direction after Leo passed, and they were trying to know the face that they would put out to the world, he was able to step in at that point and really give them some direction, and did the work, the hard work that was necessary to keep them focused in that. And I think that's one of the things that has kept them as focused and as well preserved as they are in putting the work of the Russells out. I believe at one point he was responsible for making sure that books were printed and CDs were made of the talks and so forth. So he really is the heart and soul of it.
That's a good word.
Well, I met Michael, I believe, for the first time that I can remember was at the service of Leo Russell when she passed on, and he did the eulogy. And then I remember talking to Michael out by the gravesite later in the afternoon when everyone had left and his wife, and that was a very pleasant conversation. Michael was communicated with me from Ohio. Most of our communication is once in a while on the phone. We don't talk a lot. He helped put me in touch with two people that had two children's paintings, two of the great children's paintings that Walter did, of which ultimately I acquired. Well, I would say in a positive way that I think Michael has more interest now with the inquiries that he talked to us about today, about the Science Museum, the Hannibal, Missouri Museum, and so we're hopeful that there's a new beginning coming. And I know Michael is very capable. He began the Alice in Wonderland program, which he can do it. I mean, he has that in him to do it.
When Michael started, I felt that finally things were starting to be how I had always wanted them to be. Michael and I worked so well together. I talked to him on the phone from Ohio. I would see him when he would come once a year for homecoming. And over the years, I've just had more contact with Michael than any other person in my life. And he's such a wonderful man. And he is... I will always, always feel that he has been the most important person in my life. He has been so good to work with, and he has listened to me. We've kept the business going. It's been difficult. It's, you know, we both have had our personal challenges, but we've always been a good team. He's always been very kind to me. He's extremely kind and loving man, and I don't think I could ever have asked to work with someone like him. It was just a gift. It was a gift. We're set now to open things up. I like that Michael has started the opening with the museum in Baltimore, with the Mark Twain thing. I think that he's begun the opening up of this closed, small little business. And I think now we're ready to go farther.
And Lao Russell, and of her word for what we call death, is refolding. I think it's a beautiful way to describe what we have fearful of saying death when you cannot die. But Lao refolded on May 5th of 1988 at age 84. I was named by the board of directors to succeed her as president at that time. And I was a pharmaceutical sales executive and had a long career. And I tried the balancing of that, and I was so out of balance and trying to raise family, keep the operations of being in the pharmaceutical sales capacity, and yet, handle the presidency. Very self-evident and very quickly to me that I couldn't do it, so I had left the presidency within the year. And then I was in the middle of, I guess the most important, as Lao Russell would always said, having children is the greatest gift on the face of the planet if you so have it, but it's also the greatest responsibility. All my children had met Lao Russell in their life. All my children had been raised with this comprehension of light. And I now can say the manifested results of that are just the most marvelous four raised adults, their mates, and that I have seven wonderful grandchildren. And we finally reach the year of 2003, and I was in a position finally that I was alone. My wife and I had a divorce at 30 years, at the lowest point of my life. She was killed in an automobile tractor-trailer wreck, a horrific experience, another point in life to thank God that I had the teachings I do and knew my God. I don't know what it'd be like to have experiences such as that, to know that you do not die, but still that you're going through one of the valleys of life, and that to know your God, that I need him to get through. And I saw at that point in my life, and living alone, I could devote and give concentration back to the energies of this work. So I literally approached this board, and it was in need of a new leadership point again, and offered my services again, accepted by the board, and I started in 2004, knowing that we were in a new period of the internet becoming, and the good, bad, and ugly of it, becoming more prevalent and powerful in all our lives. And I felt that this is a natural transition, too, that I'm observing, of a continualness of towards our irrefutable seeing of our oneness across this planet. It seems so self-evident to me that anywhere on this planet, at any moment, any individual that says they desire to get a hold of somebody else and communicate, or even see them now in this age with Skyping, can do it. And I may add at this point, the beginning was a very fascinating period for me of, I used to sit with Lao Russell when she could only dream about a book being sold in China or a book being sold in the countries of the Soviet Union. One of the things I had always watched with Lao Russell, I had this wonderful opportunity. She does precede no Amazons, no internet, no smartphones. People actually spoke to each other. Lao Russell wrote letters, and Lao Russell spoke on the phone to people. I used to watch her be so exhausted almost beyond belief. And they would ask her one more time, somebody has called. And there'd be a sigh often, and she was a human being, and oh, I don't want to talk anymore, but she would. And then I'd watch her just start re-energizing, and giving everything she's got to that person on that telephone call. I used to watch her write handwritten letters, of which I received many of these. Well, I understand how life-changing those were to people, and that's the kind of energy she never stopped giving out. I truly say I had to always work all this around in some tough economic times and a very tight budget, that I was very proud of doubling book sales on a very tight budget, so I knew there was good effect happening. But the hard, gritty work on a very limited staff was the day-to-day operations to make sure I kept these books going out across the world. May not mean much to anybody else in terms of what are your accomplishments, but they felt really good to me to know what I had done over that time period.
And I think that's going to happen. I believe that whatever Walter Russell, the template he made, is being fulfilled. And so I'm going to miss Michael if I don't talk to him 4 days a week. But I do think that he will always have an important part in the Russells. And I hope that, I hope that we both, continue to be a part of the Russells. I would love to continue to serve the greater good and to hold the Russells so close in my heart no matter what I do.
The piece that's resonated the most with me is what Lao emphasized as living philosophy, meaning how do you take the information, the wisdom, the knowledge, apply it day in and day out to the lessons that come to you in your life, the people, the events, the things you have to deal with. That's where the rubber hits the road. So for me, it's all about love. When I look at the PM Magazine interview with Lao Russell, and they ask her, what do you want to be remembered for? And that was her answer. I want to be remembered for love. And so I want to be remembered for love too.
Well, the first thing that comes to my mind is the Walter Russell quote, which is, the foundation of the universe is love, balance, and unity. And to me, that encompasses most all of it. Those three simple things. And it sounds so simple, but we as a community and as a body of the world is just very, very challenging to do. Because we're still having wars and we're still having conflict.
I believe the greatest strength of the university is the fact that there are now people coming in from all over the world to reinforce it. It had become lost in a diversity that it had lost its focus, is what I'm trying to say. The university had lost its focus. and the message had been watered down in ways that made it less powerful, in my opinion. Now a lot of dedicated students are coming in from all over the world to refocus that desire energy to deliver to the message as it was left to the world, untouched by other hands. That's, I think, where the hope lies, where its future lies, and I see it going in that direction. And let me finish by saying, I absolutely 100% believe that it is a message that will save humanity from a very long, dark age.
The university's strength is that it's still the University of Science and Philosophy, and the more the message is shared by other students, the more the knowledge will increase and people will learn how to go inside and become one with their creator. The whole possibility of the heart-to-heart connection, which is humanity's destiny eventually. But we have eternity.
For a long time, I and other students felt that the people that were in charge of the university were not doing enough to get the message out to humanity. And we were resentful toward the university for that and the people that were in charge of it. And that is the wrong approach and the wrong direction. We were saying to the university, what can you do to get the message out to the world, instead of what can we do to help you get the message out to the world? That's the big change that I see happening. And seeing that they're open and receptive to that help is wonderful. And I believe together we'll lovingly get it done.
Naturally, it was a blow to leave our home at Swannanoa, because this had been a safe haven, one chosen by Leo herself with Walter, and a place that we had hoped would be a perpetual physical location of the university. I think from the very earliest time we all realized that the real key was the message, not the collection of art and not the home or the situs. But nonetheless, we do have to have a physical plane on which to operate. I've been extremely pleased, number one, that we're able to come back here through the graciousness of Phil Delaney, and that we're able to have these homecomings every year, which bring an ever-widening circle of people who have become acquainted through the years with the Walter Russell and Lao Russell legacy. But the real gift is the fact that through internet communications, modern communication systems, we're able to extend the message far more than Leo was ever able to do. To see that happen, it, of course, is a geometric expansion of the work, and I'm hoping that that will continue. I don't know what exactly, there'll always be a physical home. Certainly there has to be a situs for the art. I want to see more of the art exhibited, as we will be doing for a year in Baltimore at the American Visionary Art Museum and other places, I hope. But aside from that, the key thing is to bring this message to the hearts of as many people as we possibly can. It is universal, it transcends religion. It doesn't conflict with the open, free exercise of the great religions of the world. In fact, it encapsulates them in a beautiful way. And I think it's so important that mankind learns this. That would be my hope.
I would say that the work of the university, its greatest contribution is really the knowledge. I think a lot of people, they don't realize that the power is really with them. They always look outside of themselves for power. They do feel, unfortunately, a little downtrodden, I think, by our media. And I think the university, the greatest power we could have in making any kind of change is if people would turn the TV off, because it's surprising the little value of content on TV today. So if they could draw inward and really study the written word that's been offered by the University of Science and Philosophy and specifically the Walter Russell's books and material, their home study course. The one thing that I took away really from the university's material is the practicality of spirituality. Lao Russell did not sit still for very long. She was always working. And you want to express creativity. If you see injustice, you want to react to it. You want to bring balance to anything that you see as unjust. And that was really the epitome of their teachings. And so I would say the study of the written word, or if it's in a multimedia presentation, studying that so that you can better help restore balance to men's human relations. Yeah.
I remember I read somewhere that when Nikola Tesla, who was the father of the electrical age as we know it, and the father of alternating current, also an unrecognized genius of this country, spoke with Dr. Russell about his work, he said, you should put your work in a time capsule, I think he said for 1,000 years. Only then will mankind be ready for what you've given. And, you know, I'm terribly optimistic about the future of humanity. I never get overly distressed by, you know, the terrible things we hear in the news, which are really put out there to scare us. Quite the contrary, I see very clearly a new culture arising right in our midst. And I think Dr. Russell and Lao Russell's work is very important to support that. And they gave the secrets that if Americans could understand it, and the rest of the world for that matter, I think will lead us into a new world and a new age. And I can see that happening right now. And that's my hope for the future of humanity.
I believe that that time of the Russells is coming. If it wasn't for Lao encouraging Walter to put this out at the time he did, we couldn't have found it. And other people couldn't have found that. I think this really, not just a heartfelt work Lao did, but the knowledge that they put out, I see that the time of the university is coming. I really think it's in the next few years it's going to rise up more. More people are going to be exposed to it because we're looking for a universal message that takes us into the 21st century. And we don't really have a message like that. We have pieces and parts of it. So it's a really great foundation that can guide people, can inspire them, but the knowledge contained in it can help them lift their own selves up. And the heart message of Lao really helps you connect with your own heart and the love she puts out. There is a couple, I just believe they have a really great balanced message, and that's what people are looking for. Very grounded, very practical. And that's what we need.
I think we've come to a point now where, in terms of technology, people are, scientists and so forth, are beginning to understand what Walter Russell talked about.
Yes.
And hopefully they can start pulling that in because of what's going on the planet right now. They can pull that into some practical technology that will help us to live more easily and gently upon this planet. And as far as Lao Russell was concerned, she talked about the heart. Well, the first thing that the people who encountered Lao Russell had to do was to take that message into themselves, to shift and change themselves. And that's a lot of hard work. But we've spent 20, 30, whatever number of years doing that. And now many of her students, the people who learned from her, are teaching in their own way. They're sharing that same message out there in the world and taking it into a broader audience. So in that way, Lao Russell's message is being taken out, the message of the heart.
The deeper we go in science, the more we find the universal intelligence he talked about. The deeper we go, we find a living intelligence that's heart-centered. And that is really important in the times we are living.
My great hope through media is that this work, because of its total encompassing of what the message of all religions is, which is love ye one another, that this work may blossom to worldwide, which was the hope that the Russells had. And I think that's still possible.
The strength, I think, of the university came into being when Walter and Lao came together. We heard a speaker today talking about the science, the pattern, what Walter saw as what is in the reality of the universe. But Leo, she was so, okay, well, so what? What do we do with it? How do we take this out into the universe? How do we make what Walter knew become a reality and a positive force for creating change? Their underlying pattern is what we can take forward and bring into the present tense to help get out there. And it draws people and energizes people to find their mission, to be who they are, and to bring themselves alive as a part of the part of the universe that belongs to them.
It's a message of love. And it's a message of scientific comprehension of that, as we live in a scientific age. And that loving one is the only way and the only answer of our morass that we're in across this entire world.